the scriptures had predicted the resurgence of Vedic knowledge all over the world. Saints had foreseen the appearance of a person who would fulfill this prophecy. The darkness of ignorance would not last for long, for the sun was destined to rise.
The seas have played an important role in the history of India. They have been India's contact with foreign lands. It was by sea that ancient traders came, attracted by India's richness and beauty. And it was by sea that the British had arrived and conquered the country. It was in this enslaved India that I was born on September 1, 1896 in Calcutta, the capital of the country. Europeans and Indians lived separately, although in business and education they intermingled. While remaining loyal to the British Crown, Indians followed their traditional religion and culture. Our house at 151 Harrison Road was situated in North Calcutta. My father, Gaur Mohan De, was a cloth merchant by profession. He was very pious, a devotee of Lord Krishna. He named me Abhaya Charan. Mother was 30 when I was born. She was chaste and pious, dedicated to caring for her husband and children. I saw my parents live together peacefully. No marital conflict or dissatisfaction ever threatened home. The earliest memories I have are of the Radha Govinda temple, which was situated just across the street. It was a place almost daily visited by our family and relatives. I remember standing at the doorway of the temple, praying and hearing the melodious devotional songs. I would watch for hours together. I was very fascinated by the famous festival of chariots of Jagannath Puri, which attracted thousands of people from all over India. Father bought me a small 4 feet high cart, which I decorated and started celebrating my very own festival with my friends. Like the celebrations in Puri, my festival too ran for 8 consecutive days. Family members and neighbors also joined in the procession. Although everything I did was imitation, my devotion was genuine, and each successive year brought a new festival which I observed with the same enthusiasm. For me, my world was my small house, my loving parents, and my festivals. I needed nothing more. But the world outside was a different one. It was a world of suffering and death. When I was 13, Hindu-Muslim riots broke out in Calcutta. Harsh reality of life continued to confront me. Mother suddenly died. Her death was an abrupt lowering of the curtain, ending my tender childhood. I was deeply affected. Father gave me solace. The soul is eternal and everything happens by the will of God. Have faith and just depend upon him. I understood. But life for me had changed. I was now forced to grow up. Childhood had ended. Life in college was demanding. No longer was I free to spend hours at the Radha Govinda temple. That had been a childhood luxury. Now I spent my days within the compound of the Scottish Church's college, studying Western logic, chemistry, or psychology. The atmosphere in college was academic. But the events taking place in the country had their influence. India was passing through a critical period. The movement for independence was gathering momentum. College was strict in forbidding anti-government propaganda, but students were sympathetic to the cause of home rule. Although there were no signs of open rebellion, we sometimes felt nationalistic meetings in secret. I heard names well known in India, Surendranath Banerjee, Lala Lajpat Rai, and of course, Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi. I was attracted by him. Gandhi always carried a Bhagavad Gita and spoke of being guided by its philosophy. His personal habits were pure. Gandhi abstained from all intoxication, meat eating, and illicit sex. He led a life of simplicity. I read his speeches and followed his activities. Maybe he could carry spirituality into the field of action. Gandhi called for complete non-cooperation, boycott of everything British, commodities, courts, military honors, schools and colleges. I responded to his call by rejecting my college degree. I put aside my mill manufactured clothes and took to wearing hand-spun khadi. This was not a clothing fair. It was a political statement. It meant I was Gandhian.
You must meet this saint from Mayapur. He is...
Oh, no, Naren. I know all these saints and gurus. They are just beggars fooling people to collect donations. No, no, I am not going.
You must come. This particular guru seems to be a very learned scholar. You know, he's Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati, the founder of Gaudiya Math. Remember?
Oh, no, Naren. Please don't behave this way. Nare Baba, I am not going.
Just for a while, oh boy. We won't be long. Just a while.
On the roof of the Gaudiya Math Center, Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati sat with a few disciples and guests. Upon seeing me and my friend, he immediately said, "You are young men. Why don't you spread the message of Bhagavad Gita throughout the whole world?" I was a little surprised. I protested, "Who will listen to your message? First, India must get freedom. How can we spread Indian culture if we are under British rule?" He replied, "God consciousness doesn't need a change in Indian politics. It is so important that it cannot wait. No man-made political system can actually help humanity. Only by turning towards God, following His instructions, can we achieve peace. This is the verdict of the scriptures." From that day on, my life changed. I was deeply impressed by that first meeting with Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati. Being from a pious family, I could appreciate what he was preaching. Of course, he was preaching to everyone, but he found something in me, and I was convinced by his argument and the mode of presentation. For the first time in my life, I felt defeated. But I knew this was not a defeat. It was an immense gain. I felt that I had met a very nice, saintly person, and I accepted him as my spiritual master in my heart. But I was now a married man, and due to family obligations, I could not take up preaching immediately. Having shifted to Allahabad, I started a pharmaceutical business and traveled frequently throughout northern India. But soon, I was in for a setback. Father passed away. I felt his loss immensely. He was my dearmost protector and friend. After mother's death, my dependence on him had increased, and he had fulfilled his responsibility perfectly, never giving me a chance to complain. For me, he was the embodiment of love and affection, an ideal father who had been careful to raise me as a God-conscious person. He had always desired the best for me, and I knew I could rely upon him. That well-wisher was now gone. The Bhagavad Gita, for which I had held fascination since childhood, assumed greater relevance in my life. Considered to be the essence of Vedic knowledge, the Gita, with remarkable clarity, reveals to us the nature of the absolute truth. The truth, which is the cause of all causes, the supreme personality of Godhead. I was deeply impressed by the path of unconditional, selfless, pure devotion to God propagated by the Gita. Even though there exist different paths of attaining the truth, all processes culminate in devotion and depend on it for success. Other processes purify a person from material contamination, elevate him to the spiritual platform, but only devotion can reveal the truth in totality. My life was changing, but along with this, emerged problems in my family. I had hoped that my wife and children would join me in my quest for the truth. I tried encouraging them, but somehow they did not share my enthusiasm. Probably it was the sense of insecurity that forced them to take a negative stance. I could understand them. I never felt offended nor did I blame them for it. I just hoped that they would realize the importance of what I was trying to do. In the autumn of 1935, I was with my spiritual master in the holy city of Vrindavan, taking a walk on the banks of Radhakunda. There had been quarreling amongst some of Bhakti Siddhanta's leading disciples, and this distressed him. If they were fighting now, what would they do after he had passed away? Deeply concerned, he told me, "One day there will be fire in the Gaudiya Math, which will spread and destroy." I felt the urgency with which he spoke, and then he directly instructed me. I had a desire to print books. If you ever get money, print books. I never asked my spiritual master any question except one. How can I serve you? In the winter of 1936, I received a letter from him in which he once again repeated the same instruction I had received during our very first meeting. He asked me to preach Vedic knowledge all over the world. I took this letter as a confirmation. Now there was no doubt about the purpose of my life. This was the first instruction I had received from him, and ironically, the last one too. 2 weeks later, Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati passed away. In 1939, the Second World War had begun. Lord Linlithgow, the Viceroy of India, announced that India was at war with Germany. Indian soldiers were dispatched to battlefields in Egypt, Iraq and Burma. Calcutta was bombed day after day. As the fire of the World War raged throughout the planet, the fire in the Math predicted by Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati also broke out. Two parties emerged to be successors to their guru. Quarreling and fist fighting broke out. They sued each other in court. The preaching of the Gaudiya Math stopped. Even though I was not involved in the faction fighting, I was deeply affected. I realized the importance of strictly following the instructions of the guru, as emphasized by the Gita. Any deviation or loss of faith could lead to failure. In the midst of these calamities, I felt more than ever the need to spread Krishna consciousness. I had something to say to the world. When a man forgets that he is the son of Godhead and identifies himself with the body, he is like a man who is ever concerned with the automobile's mechanism, yet with no knowledge of the driver. The world's political leaders are expressing their disgust at their people's suffering and scarcity. After 4 years of fighting, costing millions of lives, the Second World War is still scourging the earth. Although the end is in sight, leaders have expressed not so much happiness and hope as weariness and uncertainty. Even if this war ended, would there be yet another war? Had man not yet grasped the vital lesson of how to live in peace? Without spiritual knowledge, there cannot be a solution to war. India, guided by God, can lead the world back to sanity. Being impressed by my humble endeavors, my God brothers awarded me the title Bhakti Vedanta. I accepted it with a feeling of responsibility. I knew I had to live up to it. One night, I had an unusual dream. My spiritual master appeared to me beckoning. "Oh boy, leave home, give up business, renounce the world, take sannyas." I woke up in an intensely emotional state. My spiritual master was giving me a specific instruction, but I could not give up my family immediately. Besides, my business was running successfully. I needed to earn money, not just for supporting my family, but also for preaching. Still, I remain shaken by the dream. 1947. Like millions of others, I was also affected by the violent dawn of Indian independence. The freedom movement, which was started with the aim of uniting India, had ended in partition. Riots flared up throughout the country. One party was Hindu, the other Muslim. They fought and many died. And after death, no one could understand who was Hindu, who was Muslim. They simply had to be cleared from the road. I was not expecting independence to bring any solutions. Unless the people of the country were God conscious, what change would there be? A few months later, my business suffered a major setback. My servants and employees stole almost everything. The loss was immense, and the business could not be revived. This certainly was a serious blow, but somehow I saw the present circumstances through the eyes of the scripture. I remembered a verse from the Srimad Bhagavatam where Lord Krishna says, "When I feel specially merciful towards someone, I gradually take away all his possessions." I was never disinclined to pursue my business. But it seemed God was forcing me. "You must give it up." And I realized that he was gradually freeing me for actively pursuing my mission. I left for Jhansi. This time not for business, but for preaching. During a morning walk with one of my acquaintances, I spotted the Bharati Bhavan, an old temple complex. I was interested and decided to have a closer look. Across one of the sides of the stone temple, I saw a Sanskrit inscription, "Hare Ramo, Hare Ramo, Ramo Ramo, Hare Hare." This was a part of the Mahamantra propagated by Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and spreading his teachings was the aim of my life. I considered this inscription a sign from God. Turning to my accomplice, I said strongly, "The Lord has built this building for my use." The Bharati Bhavan was built in 1939 as a memorial to a wealthy landowner, but was not in use for a few years, and I was told that if the custodian, Mr. Bhoyal, agreed to give the building in charity, I could use it for my preaching. Extremely enthusiastic, I began thinking, "In this room, we will have discourses and lectures. This will be the temple room. Guests here, printing press there." Somehow, I convinced Mr. Bhoyal. And here in Bharati Bhavan, I started the League of Devotees. In 1857, Rani Lakshmibai, the Queen of Jhansi, had started a political revolution against the British. The rebellion had then spread to the entire country, posing a serious challenge to the foreign rulers. And now, 100 years later, I was attempting to start a spiritual revolution, which I hoped would engulf the entire world. But soon, problems followed. Earlier, Mr. Bhoyal had offered the Bharati Bhavan in charity to the League of Devotees, but when I approached him for a deed of gift, he asked me to pay 5,000 rupees and buy it. All of a sudden, the generous gift had turned into a purchase offer. There was no way in which I could raise this money in Jhansi. So, I decided to go to Calcutta. On returning home, I was confronted by the inevitable realization which had been lurking in my mind for many years. I was 58 and it was time for me to retire from family life. This is recommended by the Vedic scriptures. A person is advised to detach himself from his family in the later stages and dedicate himself completely in the service of God. Besides, over the years, I had drifted apart from my family. One day, a serious incident took place. My wife took my copy of the Bhagavatam to the market and exchanged it for biscuits. When I returned home and looked for the book, she told me what happened. I was shocked. A wave of absolute resolution passed over me. I decided to leave home. My relationship with my family, anyway, was a tight one. There was no point in continuing. Now my sons were well settled. Relatives were also there to provide support. There had been many people in past history who had given up their family for a higher cause. They had risked being misunderstood and condemned, and it would be the same for me. But I had to do it. I had fulfilled my duties towards my family. Now I had to fulfill my duty towards the world. As I left, my family thought I would soon be back. But only I knew it was all over. I would never return. Upon my return to Jhansi, I met with competition for possession of the Bharati Bhavan. The wife of the governor decided to take over the building for organizing a women's society. I tried to resist, but I was driven out. Just like the rebellion of 1857 had failed, my attempt of establishing a spiritual movement had also ended unsuccessfully. For this cause, I had left my family. And now, having been thrown out of there, I had nowhere to go. I had been to Vrindavan several times, but they had been brief visits. This time I was going there to stay. Here, 5,000 years ago, my Lord Sri Krishna had manifested his earthly pastimes. This was the most sacred place for all Hindus. To live and die in Vrindavan guaranteed liberation from material sufferings and an eternal existence in the spiritual world. I was already 60 years old, but like others, I had not come to Vrindavan to retire. Rather, I had come because it was the ideal place to gain spiritual strength. Here, I wanted to prepare for my mission. On September 17, 1959, at Keshavji Gaudiya Math, I accepted the renounced order of life, Sunnash. Now I was A.C. Bhakti Vedanta Swami. For me, accepting this new title did not mean just changing to saffron and giving up family, home, business. This I had already done. It had a greater significance. It was the mandate I required, the irrevocable commitment. Now, it was only a matter of time before I would travel to the West. The knowledge contained in the Vedic scriptures had been protected by the Sanskrit language for centuries. But now, the secret had to be released to the world. If I had to succeed, I had to translate the scriptures into English. I began with the Srimad Bhagavatam. In Vrindavan, I stayed at the Radha Damodar temple. It was here that Lord Chaitanya's most intimate disciples, Roop and Jeev Goswami, had resided 400 years ago. I knew that they wanted me to go to the West. And somehow God had brought me here to receive their blessings. Writing was only half the battle. The other half was publishing. For this, I had to go to Delhi. In the heart of Chipiwada, near Jama Masjid, was the narrow entrance of a Radha Krishna temple. On the second floor was a room given to me by a well-wisher, Krishna Pandit. This was my office in Delhi. We know that our honest attempt in presenting this great scripture, conveying the transcendental message for reviving the God consciousness of people in general, is fraught with many difficulties. Our capacity of presenting the philosophy in adequate language will certainly fail, and there may be so many discrepancies in spite of our attempt to present it in the proper way. But we are sure that with all our faults in this connection, the seriousness of the subject matter will be taken into consideration, and the leaders of the society will still accept this on account of its being an honest attempt for glorifying the Almighty. The first volume of the Srimad Bhagavatam was ready. The message of God awaited its readers. But India had changed. People were blindly imitating the West, giving up their own culture. It was such an irony. Though theoretically Indians praised their traditions, they accepted Western thoughts and way of life without hesitation in practice. In such a situation, distributing Srimad Bhagavatam was not easy. I walked through the dusty roads of Delhi in the intense heat. Sometimes this was difficult to bear. I often dreamt of going to New York. It had become an obsession. But how this would happen, I did not know. In July 1964, I was in Bombay. The aim of my coming here was to raise funds for my printing. I had visited Bombay earlier, during the days of my business. I was fairly successful then, young and well respected. But now I had come as an old renunciant, alone and poor. I attempted to arrange a meeting with Shumati Morarji, the chairman of the Sindhya Steam Navigation Company, as I had heard that she helped saints and religious people. But her officers didn't allow me in. Frustrated, I waited for over 5 hours at the entrance and finally managed to catch her attention. As Shumati Morarji went through the typed manuscripts and the published volume of the Srimad Bhagavatam, I watched her with great apprehension. Suddenly she said, "All right, I will give you the aid. Whatever you want, you can get it printed." Shumati Morarji appreciated my ideals. She herself was a very pious lady, much interested in Vedic philosophy. She requested me to read Srimad Bhagavatam to her. Every evening, we'd sit together in her garden. I meditate upon Lord Krishna because he is the absolute truth, the primeval cause of all causes of the creation, sustenance, and destruction of the manifested universes. He is directly and indirectly conscious of all manifestations, and he is independent because there is no other cause beyond him. One day, I was in for a pleasant surprise. The Ministry of External Affairs informed me that my no objection certificate for going to the United States was ready. But I had not instigated any proceedings. Then how did this happen? I was shown the declaration form signed by one Mr. Gopal Agrawal of Pennsylvania, in which he solemnly declared that he would bear the expenses of my stay in America. I then recollected. About 3 months ago, I had met a businessman and had mentioned to him in passing that I wanted to go to America to preach. The businessman had volunteered that he would ask his son Gopal to sponsor my visit. And now it had happened. I could not believe my eyes.
No, Swamiji. I cannot give you a free ticket on my steamship. You are too old. And I doubt whether you will be able to accomplish anything.
You must help me, Mr. Murarji. Now I have a sponsor. It is a real chance to fulfill the mission of my life.
You know what my secretaries think? They say you are going there to die.
That is nonsense. You will see, Mrs. Murarji, I will be successful.
Okay, Swamiji, I will give you a free ticket.
The day before my departure from Calcutta, I travelled to Mayapur to visit the Samadhi of Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati. I recollected our first meeting. 43 years had passed since then. All along, I had struggled to fulfill his instructions. At last, I had got a chance, and I prayed for his blessings. The day had arrived. Besides me in the taxi sat Shishir Bhattacharya, a singer I had met a year ago. He was not my relative, not a disciple, not even a close friend. He was just an acquaintance who was willing to help. It was such an irony. In my native city, Calcutta, where I was born and brought up, where I lived for the greater part of my life, today I had no one even to see me off. I have my wife and sons, daughters, grandsons, everything. But I have no money, so they are a fruitless glory. Where have my loving father and mother gone? And where are all my elders, who were my own folk? Who will give me news of them? Tell me who. All that is left of this family is a list of names. Old and physically weak, I was leaving on an almost impossible mission. I realized that I was going to an unknown and probably an unwelcoming country. To be poor and unknown in India was one thing. Even in these days of degradation, when Indians, influenced by the West, were giving up their culture, it was still India. It was still the remains of Vedic civilization. Here I had been able to see millionaires, governors, the prime minister, simply by showing up at their doors and waiting. A saint in India was respected. The Bhagavad Gita was respected. But in America, it would be different. There had been no one, a lone foreigner. Standing on the deck, I watched as the ship slowly sailed away. The Indian shore, which drifted further and further away, reminded me of the struggle I had undergone. And the sea before me, on the other hand, reminded me of the struggle that was in store ahead. The British had come to India by sea and had won it over by its strong military might. And now, also traveling by sea, I was making a humble attempt to win over the West for India, not by any weapons, but by the message of love, love of God. With 40 rupees and the handful of possessions I was carrying with me, my mission certainly seemed difficult to accomplish. In fact, I had no idea of how it could happen. But I knew this was Lord Krishna's plan, and so it would surely happen. In fact, the temples already exist. Devotees exist. Books exist. Only time separates us.
After a 37-day long journey, during which he suffered two heart attacks, Prabhupada finally reached America. Having stayed briefly in Pennsylvania, he moved on to New York, where in July 1966, Prabhupada established the International Society for Krishna Consciousness. The rest is history.
Krishna tadiya padapam kajapanyarantam adyaiva visatume manasarajahansa prana prana samai kaphavata pitau kanthavarodhan vidhau